नमस्कार नंदिनी, वेलकम वेलकम टू अहिंसा कॉन्वर्सेशंस. थैंक यू सो मच.
थैंक यू सो मच रजनी.
अरे
इट्स अ बिट हार्ड एंड डिफिकल्ट टॉपिक यू नो, एंड थैंक्स फॉर थिंकिंग आई कैन स्पीक ऑन इट यू नो,
बिकॉज
आई ट्राई माय बेस्ट.
बिल्कुल नो, बिकॉज योर एक्सपीरियंस of so many diverse moments in our political and social life, I felt was important to cover here. So we'll begin at the same question, that what is your earliest recollection from childhood of either the concept or the experience of nonviolence?
Frankly speaking, Rajni, my growing up years, I was very privileged child, you know, coming from the upper caste class community, majority community. So only had to experience ahimsa, you know, I mean, there was no direct hinsa on me. So it's only one realizes now how privileged it is not to be in some basti in a city where you don't know when a bulldozer will come and demolish it, calling it illegal, or not born as a scheduled tribe member and not knowing when a development project would come and throw us off my land, or not belonging to a Dalit community, which is, you know, outside a village, continuous humiliation. So I grew up experiencing, I mean, I knew nothing else except nonviolence, right? And it was only when I went to school and then studied it as theory, and I used to not relate very much because what's so great about it? That's how life is. There's no violence around us. Nobody taught us that this is only because you come from a very privileged section of the society that you are not threatened by any form of violence. We are mostly the perpetrators of violence, not the recipients of violence. And in theory, one learned first the non-violence of Buddha, the Gandhian thought, I being a Gujarati, both these theories, Jainism influence is quite heavy in Gujarat. So that is again a part of the culture. And as I said, you know, non-violence was, it was part of our privileged life. And the only time I felt non-violence, violence on me was on account of my gender, actually. That was the first time I felt vulnerable, because in class 5, I remember I was followed by a boy and it was a terrifying experience, you know. He stalked me every day. But today when I think back, you know, I mean, it was not the physical violence, but that he followed me around wherever I went. It made me feel very insecure. But that was also handled very quickly, you know, for being coming from a good privileged family. So what I remember now of that incident is that the boy's father came to apologize at our place. He was a milkman, delivery man. And I see the fear in the father's eyes that, my God, what will happen to his family now? You know, what would my family do to his family? And that has stuck to me, because I came out pretty okay. You know, nothing happened to me. But that stays. And so I now think that had I been a daughter of a Dalit family or a landless family or working at a zamindar's house and the son had not been a milkman's son, but, you know, some very powerful person, what would my condition be? So the privilege is there all along, and that's how I grew up. And so nonviolence, it's only when my father made us conscious of this injustice and inequality in the society, and that led me to do my MSW and then finally join the NBA. So
when did you, where did you do your MSW, Nandini? Where was your MSW done?
I did it in Baroda, and my placement was in Central Jail. There again, I saw, you know, that the perpetrators of violence are outside the jail. And,
go ahead.
The perpetrators of violence are outside the jail and the recipients are inside the jail. You know, we had a couple of women who were involved in sex trade who were in jail because they were soliciting customers, and that's a crime. Now, they were you know, we had very petty. So you had a sex worker who's recipient of violence, and the law puts her behind bars because soliciting is a crime. The customer is not. So then you have petty, you know, some woman just peddling small amounts of drugs and just to make ends meet, and she's in jail. Or, you know, some petty theft, pocket mar on a bus stand. So again, you know, that whole thing of who are the perpetrators of violence and who are the recipients. And it's very much associated to the caste, class you belong to, you know, and the majority community. So that realization was there in MSW also.
Yeah. How did that lead to Narmada Bachao Andolan? You were doing your MSW, I imagine, in the late 1980s.
Yes, I graduated in 87. And like all Gujaratis or all Indians, I grew up studying, you know, that big dams development. In Gujarat, there was a massive thrust for Sardar Sarovar project because it was considered a jiva dori. A whole generation, not just mine, but previous to mine also grew up believing that this dam will solve our water problem permanently. In fact, I grew up looking forward to it, you know, that chalo. And I belong to a drought-prone area of Gujarat, Saurashtra. So we have always grown up with scarcity in water. Not that it was in my home, again, privileged. I never had to go with pot full, I mean, go and fetch water from wells and walk several kilometers. No, but one was aware and one wanted that the water problem is solved by this dam. It was only after doing a job in decentralized water management, you know, structures in Saurashtra, and then subsequently taking a tour of other people's work, that I came across this massive rally in Bhopal where people were opposing Sardar Sarovar, and that really shook me. I said, why? It's a jiva dori. Why are people protesting? I went back and studied the dams and found that not only was it not going to solve the water problem, but it was going to displace thousands and thousands of people. It was going to be massive impact on environment loss. It was decentralized water management, you know, at minimum cost to people and environment. And that's when I joined the NBA, moved on to the other side of the fence. In 1990, I joined and was a full-time activist for 12 years. Yeah.
So now I think you came in touch with another dimension. What you mentioned from your childhood background about ahimsa being taken for granted in the daily life was absence of violence. But now once you became involved in NBA, you were in a political domain where non-violence as a method of political action was being adopted. So can you describe how firstly you related or did not relate to that, what doubts you had, and how did it play out? Because you were deep in the you know, deep inside the grassroots of the movement. So whatever you can tell us about that, how did this actually play out in practice?
Yeah, that was the time when this whole thing came with a bang, you know, that the perpetrators of violence is the state, which is representing the haves, the privileged section. You know, we don't even go and grab ourselves. We have raised this, created these structures, social, legal, governance structures that play out, you know, displace people for our benefit. You know, we don't even go to the ground. Violence for the benefit of a certain section of the society. I saw it viciously being played out on the marginalized communities, the tribals, the farmers, the fisher people, the Adivasi people.
These were people who were going to be affected by the displacement, right? That's what you're
talking about. In fact, the displaced people's movement, the Narmada Bachao Andolan, which I joined, their demand was that this project has been planned several decades ago. There were not many facts, figures. It's going to have huge impact on people. Displacement is huge, environment costs. So what we need is to sit across a table. Let us review this project, halt the dam and the work for some time, let us have a time-bound review. This was a demand of the people to be displaced by this project. And they were not one or two villages, you know, 245 villages. So this was the demand. And, you know, it was not just that two or three villages or a certain section of the road is small lands are going. It was 245 villages in the submergent zone of the Sardar Sarovar project with a population of 250,000 people. And another 250,000 people were to be impacted because of the project infrastructure. So it was a huge number that was going to be displaced and affected. And their demand was simple, you know, that halt the work, show us if there is a rehabilitation master plan, show us if there are studies, environment studies, or if there are alternatives that have been considered. Let us have a time-bound review of the project, you know. And when this demand was put forth, very reasonable demand, I feel, what people received was unprecedented state repression. And I've seen it with my own eyes. I've seen 700, 800 armed police enter Manibeli, the first village to be submerged for survey to remove people, you know, who were willing to, of course, go. But people said that why do you want to enter, armed forces want to enter our villages? But it was the policy of the government ki flood the Narmada Valley with khaki, intimidate them, so they leave. So when people protested that we have no business to have armed police in our villages, they were, in fact, people were arrested. If they would have very severe cases put on them, we have a senior tribal leader, a woman leader, who refused to move out of her village because rehabilitation was not there, was raped in police custody. I have myself been witness to police firing in Chichkedi, one of the Adivasi villages, where a very young boy, just a teenager, Remal Punya Vasava, was shot dead. Whenever people protested, there were false charges clamped on them, section 309, you know, attempt to murder. Days on end, women, breastfeeding women, were in jail, not getting bail. We had to go right up to the Supreme Court. And this for a non-violent struggle, because, you know, and all that people were demanding was stop the work for some time and let us review it. Sit across. Yeah. We were not taken into confidence when you... So I have seen this. Myself have been jailed. Male activists have also been, you know, stripped in police custody. So this is the kind of violence which is perpetrated by the state for so-called development projects, you know.
Yeah, but so in the face of this much violence, the dam itself was a case of structural violence. And then the process of pushing it through involved all this repression. How did people and why did people continue for more than, well, all this while, the Andolan is still going on, to remain nonviolent? What was the impetus? Because I know that there were voices inside and on the periphery of the Andolan, which kept saying, look, you need to be aggressive. You need to respond with violence. What decided that? If you could describe something of that process, this resolve or the struggle to build the resolve.
There are two, three answers to this. There cannot be one single one, you know. I think there was a large part of people in the valley who are very aware that it is an unequal battle from the start. All the weapons are with the state. All the law is with the state. You know, there's no way we are already unarmed. I mean, we have no arms or ammunition with us. So it's an unequal battle from the very start. The perpetrators of violence through, as I said, the structures of governance have already disarmed people. There is no weapon to fight that. So what choice is left, you know? And then there is also a very large section within the valley which believed very much in this, not that they had studied, you know, the Adivasi. We had first generation Adivasi people who had studied, but many of them used to say that this is our right to life, fight for right to life, in which we don't want to take anybody else's life, you know. And so I think there was this mix of that it is an unequal battle. We do not have arms. How are we going to fight the state, which is so powerful, has all the guns, and that our own fight is for right to life, our own life, and how do we take the life of others? So these were, and I want to read out something what Gandhiji has in fact taught and said about violence, non-violence. So he said, for me, it is truth and ahimsa is religion for me. He has said this in a letter to all the Englishmen, from your faithful friend Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, and I'll read just a few lines.
Please do.
I had promised Lord Chelmsford in the war conference held at Delhi to help in the enrollment drive of the army. I did this work with the faith that my country will have equal status. Understand what imperialism means to him, that is to Indians. One, exploitation of the wealth of Hind for the benefit of Great Britain. Disregard of the poor by the government departments. And for this, in order to protect the lives of handful of Europeans living amongst us, disarming, snatching away of arms from the subjects and rendering them important, spiritless. I know that you would not mind if we could fight and snatch away our state from you. You know that we do not have the strength to do that. This is because you have not left us in the state to carry out such an open and noble battle. The doors to prove our bravery in the battlefield are closed to us. The doors to show bravery of our soul are still open to us. I know you will bow to that fervor. I'm trying to awaken that fervor among our people. So I feel it was a mix of all this, that you have disarmed us. It's an unequal battle, and also a very big consciousness that this is a fight for right to life, and we don't want to take that. So that led to the NBA. The law of the land does legalize private defense, in which if you have some attack on yourself or somebody next to you or even on your property, you are allowed. In fact, even Gandhiji has recognized that right. He has told that a village has to defend itself from external forces to the extent that it can also perish, you know. So right to self-defense, be fearless, protect your liberty. Your village has been the goal all along in our constitution. But, you know, we need to recognize that if there is a small scuffle, today it's the state that is entering villages to rob them of their resources. So if there is some, I see it in that context, that it is in self-defense, you know. So in NBA also, we did have, when police entered forcefully and pushed people around, there were small groups that would enter into a scuffle, and because there were no other arms, there could be stones throwing. But I saw it as, you know, in as per the law of the land, in self-defense, which is permitted under our law.
There are two images, Nandini, that have, are sort of etched in my memory. One is of Ferkuva, where Baba Amte, with his hands tied like this with a string, and many people in the Andolan beside him, behind him, you know, walking, crossing the line the police were holding, then saying you cannot cross into Gujarat, but with their hands folded and in this action of Namaste. That's one image. And the other is of people standing with their hands folded as the water rose and would have drowned them if they had, and I remember then that they were bodily lifted out by the police. How do you now look back on these? Because this is, Gandhi would say these are expressions of soul force, but to other, for some, from another point of view, and in fact, many people critical of the Andolan did say that it was a suicide. It was an attempted suicide to say that, you know, you'll let the water rise above your head and you'll drown rather than to submit to the displacement and eviction from your lands.
So Rajni, you know, when there was an overall consensus in the NBA that the movement will be non-violent for all the reasons I told you, and it has stuck to that for even now after so many years. There were several strategies which the movement adopted as part of nonviolence. There was dharnas, demonstrations, rallies, going to the Supreme Court, different courts, Rasta Roko, show of strength, mass gatherings, to show that it was not. And two strategies which would again be, as I would say, adopted quite by the NVA was, one was fast unto death or unlimited fast. And the other was, there are two things. One is dubenge par hatenge nahi, but there was one jal samarpan, which is where a very small but dedicated squad, if certain demands are not met by the state, would proactively take jal samarpan, would drown themselves. Not just when the waters rose, that is dubenge par hatenge nahi. People said, we'll stand up, and if water rise, you are drowning us. But jal samarpan is where you have a demand, and if that is not met by certain time, then a dedicated squad of the NVA would proactively sacrifice their lives to the dam rising waters. So indefinite fast also was taken up by the NVA with certain demands that review the project, stop the work, review the project. About these two strategies, let me read out, what people have to say, because these are again very life-threatening strategies where again lives of people are at stake. And at Ferkua also, I remember that although it brought a lot of spotlight on the movement, the government stood firm and did not accept NBA's demand. And the law of the land also, abetment to suicide, attempt to suicide is considered illegal. While private defense is legal, this is considered criminal, and had come to lift up the people on fast at Ferkua, which people had resisted, that we have a right to protest, But when it came to really endangering the lives of our own co-workers, there were seven members from the Adivasi community, from the farmers community, were sitting on fast. When we really realized that there could be death or life was threatened, then people decided, we are going to withdraw the fast. We don't want our colleagues to give up life. And hamare gaon mein hamara raj, we will fight in our villages. We will have a collective struggle. We don't want our colleagues to lose their lives. And we withdrew at Ferkua. So, and the government had not accepted the demand. So it has happened once or twice in the movement where the government has not accepted our demand, even in Jal Samarpan. The demand was halt the work of the dam in the early 90s when we had declared Jal Samarpan and review the project. We decided to withdraw the program of Jal Samarpan, though the full demand was not met, but a partial was met, that okay, we will not halt the work, but carry out a review. So people were not very, it has not happened in the NBA where our colleagues were allowed to give up their lives, some way was. So I'll read out a few things what people say about these two strategies, because that also involves death, right? If not of the perpetrators, but our own people. So yes, I'll just read out.
Yeah, please do.
You know Girish Bhai, Girish Bhai Patel, a founding member of Narmada Bachao Andolan, a very senior member.
A well-known lawyer. But this is what he has, of Baroda,
lawyer,
who was a very central figure in the Andolan.
He was very much all the time at Ferkua. He was there for all the days.
Very much. I remember him.
Frequently. He was an ideologue for the movement. This is what he has had to say about fast and Jal Samarpan. With fast, the struggle of mass collective begins to concentrate on a single individual. The Adivasis sitting at the dharna, along with the major issues, are forgotten and people become incidental. An unlimited fast is an undemocratic instrument. There is an inherent contradiction in this weapon if your movement is truly democratic. Fast unto death is being critiqued as an emotional blackmail, where people on the other side are not expected to think rationally, but are pressurized to save the life of the person on fast. fast lead to the personification of a people's movement. This happened in Gandhiji's movement and it happened in our movement also. With Jal Samarpan, there was a transition from mass action to individual action and it became an issue of moral pressure. We also know of incidences where people have died in a struggle. But after the initial shock, the impact does not match up to the expectation. In a movement, methods to be followed are dialogue and rational approach. In our movement, there was a general consensus that Jal Samarpan would not disturb the Gujarat government. Most doubted if this would bring any change in the society. This was Girish Bhai. Then we have senior members, local leaders, you know, the ousties themselves, who were going to lose their everything. One of the senior leaders of the Narmada Bachao Andolan, Rukmi Ben Patidar, an ousti herself, her village is in the submergence zone in Madhya Pradesh, a very senior member. She has this to say: if someone would have died, the people of Valley would have been responsible, wouldn't they? What would the government lose? If someone dies in this manner, they may feel good that they would have become famous, they would have become martyrs. But those who have to watch this will feel the pain that someone has given their life to save our land. And this, you know, Rajni, I've heard even senior Adivasi leaders saying that we don't want anybody to lose their life for our, we don't want to live with that burden in our history, Adivasi history, that someone gave up their life for us. But we don't want our colleagues to lose their life for us. In history, we won't be able to pardon ourselves. I've heard it myself. So Rasik Bhai Trivedi, from the first village to submerge near the dam site, Vadgam, and a senior member of the NBA, says this: programs like FAST are where you have to endure, and that is not okay. I believe in going to the government offices, to the chief minister's house, to the house of the members of legislative assembly, to the parliament, to places where our issue can be heard by people, even in front of the gates of the Supreme Court or before the sessions court. If Jal Samarpan is declared, then the government is truly not bothered and would allow him or her to drown but not rescue anyone. We should not undertake programs that cause us loss. With such programs, people get scared. Would anyone be ready to die? So such programs should not be undertaken. And one of my senior colleagues, Chittarupa Palit, you know, in a book, she has said this. The name of the book is Another World Really Possible? She says, Jal Samarpan, this was hotly debated and opposed by the Valley people and the supporters. A stance that has so far been prevented prevented such a tactic from being deployed. So taking life or giving life also, you know. So this whole thing about we are fighting for right to life. And I see that. But my issue regarding such life-threatening strategies are somewhat little different, which I will, if there is time, I would like to share.
Yeah, go ahead. Please. Corona.
Okay. My main argument as an activist of NBA and having studied other important movements also, for such high-stake, life-threatening strategies as part of the movement is not because it doesn't have legal sanction or religious sanction. You know, Buddha has said that violence to self is not okay. That is also violence. I don't see it in that context. I see it that fasts and strategies like Jal Samarpan, while would bring a spotlight on the issue and may also give some immediate relief, or it may solve some temporary demand, may not always solve the issue permanently, or the demand is not always fully met. For example, I can give you, you know, you must be aware the long fast that Sundarlal Bauguna took up for Tehri Dam, 45 days, 72 days. So there would be stoppage of work for some time, but the Tehri Dam got completed. We have Iram Sharmila, you know, fasting for 16 days. AFSPA did not get repealed. We have recently Professor G.D. Agrawal, who passed away fasting for the Ganga. So, you know, when something like this would happen, then it can be very demoralizing to the movement, you know, because you have lost the life, you have not achieved the demand as such. There could be temporary relief, there could be a spotlight. And my experience is that fast without a powerful mass movement are even less effective. You know, there has to be a powerful movement. Repeated fasts also make Jalsamarpan or fasts make the instrument blunt. I mean, we have people in the valley say that we are making our own lives cheap. You know, we can't give up our lives. The government wants it, you know, that tum maro, you die. So we don't want that to happen. As I said, it can be demoralizing. Feeling of helplessness as you see the health of your close colleagues deteriorating, you know, it can be very, very demoralizing, particularly if there is no response from the government. And mostly, you know, government has learned to deal with fast. They've dealt with Morarji Desai's fast in Gujarat, all kinds of things. The government is not scared of an individual. It is scared of mass resistance, you know. So with such individual strategies, an individual becomes more important. These individual strategies also undermine the power of the collective, you see. But most importantly to me, just two more. Such strategies also reinforce in the minds of the people that some masiha or some superhuman will come, you know, the avatar will come to save you. It makes the people lose confidence in themselves and the power of the collective, you know, and it becomes a personified movement. And so, you know, a movement like Koel Karo, which is a contemporary movement with the NBA, they changed their slogans from earlier it was Jaan Denge Par Zameen Nahi Denge. They changed it to Jaan Bhi Nahi Denge, Zameen Bhi Nahi Denge.
Can you say that in English, please? The slogan, and also just say a little bit, where is Koel Karo and what was the struggle? Assume that the person watching doesn't know this. Thanks.
Koel Karo, another dam in the Adivasi area of Jharkhand. It's a contemporary. There also the Adivasis, large number were to be displaced by this particular project. A dam project, and there has been a severe and very strong dam. This struggle is also a contemporary struggle where the slogan of the people was Jaan Denge Zameen Par Zameen Nahi Denge. We'll give up lives, but we will not give our land. But there was police firing there also. Many Adivasis were shot dead there also. After that, they said, Jaan bhi nahi denge, zameen bhi nahi denge. That we will not give up our lives, but we will not give up our land either. So we will fight, but it's not a fight to invite death upon us. We will continue. So they changed that slogan. So I feel that even the government is very keen that, you know, people's movement reduces to a few people, attention to a few people. You know, make it look like it's not a mass resistance. So we must continue with mass resistance because that is what the government is not capable of handling. And we are seeing it more and more happening in India.
Many of the quotations which you just shared, I imagine, are from the amazing long-term work that you are doing, which is to collect an oral history of the Narmada region, not just of the movement, though your primary focus may be of the movement. So in this vast volume of conversations and testimonials that you have been collecting, how do you see people, you know, responding to the fact that the government was very largely unresponsive? Firstly, is that their impression? That's my impression. That such a vast effort was mounted by the people, and the government was, in a relative sense, not very responsive. How do then people feel about their sticking with the path of nonviolence? What is the overall feeling? Because Go ahead.
Actually, the oral histories I'm collecting are only of the Sardar Sarovar Narmada movement, and I put them up on the website. People have spoken about the strategies, the, you know, impact of displacement, all of that. About 28 interviews are already out there on the website. Actually, you know, Rajni, it's very surprising that when I ask people who've already been displaced, the rehabilitation is not there, that apni haar hui hai kya? Have we been defeated? You know, the dam to ban gaya. No one has said that. People have felt that we could delay the project for so many years, such a powerful state, and yet we delayed the project by more than 20 years. They had to do, in other dams, they just simply drove away people. Here, they had to do at least some rehabilitation. We could throw the World Bank out of the project. Today also, you know, we have rights. We continue to fight. We will get our rights. If not, okay, we couldn't stop the dam, but we delayed it for so many years. We have some rehabilitation and we continue to fight. And for activists like us also, it was not demoralizing because we saw, you know, that government had to bow down at many places, acquire land, some rehabilitation took place. There was a long period in which people could get used to the idea of displacement, had some time to rehabilitate themselves. A 20-year delay for a project of this kind, you know, is not a small thing. And it was the first time in the history of World Bank it had to withdraw from a project it was funding. And institute
an independent review for the first time ever.
Yes. And when I started out, I myself was a believer of large dams, you know, and look at the change it has brought, you know, it has now a big question mark. So nobody in the valley, except, of course, I mean, there is sadness where people have lost their lives, as I said, Remal, Punya, Vasava. But people feel that it's better to go down fighting than not fight at all. And it's not like it's been all a loss, you know. There has been several landmark milestones that people have achieved. So, that's where I also want to say that, you know, what is one generation? I mean, the Adivasis, the Dalits, the women have been fighting for so many generations for their rights, you know. Yeah. It's been more than centuries. Yeah. Look at, I mean, women. Today, yeah, you and I are talking. It started out with Sati Pratha and Dood Piti Karna, and, you know, and today you and I are. So it's not as if you can change anything within a decade. It's a long struggle, and people feel they've achieved a lot. About fast, I want to, you know, there is amongst the Gandhians particularly that Gandhi advocated it as a strategy of non-violence. I want to point out that even he was not very much for fast, though he took up several himself. I want to quickly point out what he had to say about fast. I say this because I feel that there are so many movements which have taken up mass and collective resistance and have succeeded, you know. Yeah, so wherever there have been very powerful collective resistance, we have seen successes. Koel Karo, Subansiri Dam. Recently, a nuclear power plant had to withdraw from Gujarat at Mithi Virli. You know, Nandigram, Singur, so many places. And so I want to say that giving up life by fasting or some extreme step, collective resistance is more powerful. And I want to say what Gandhi has to say about fast himself. I'll just read out 2-3 paragraphs. If it's okay, we have the time.
Yes, please do.
Gandhi himself said, there is no point in fasting before a fence or a wall. You could fast for yourself for attainment of purity, but not for a few days. Don't undertake a fast against anyone at all. Do not undertake a fast to draw pity. To die like that is foolish and a sin, a crime. Indefinite fast is a rare thing to do and cannot be undertaken by anyone like you or me. That kind of a fast can be before God, not before people. And that kind of fast should not be disclosed to anyone. I wish to insist upon all that they should not fast in solidarity with me. I have undertaken this fast at the directive of God. Those who have not got this clear directive directive have no reason to fast. Fast should not be the intention of putting force. Fast should not be with the intention of putting force on anyone. And in fact, Gandhiji, you know, asked several people to withdraw their fast. Senapati Bapat in early 30s, he told him, you withdraw your fast. He told the Munshi Satyagraha is the first anti-dam struggle in the country when they were jailed. And when they were in jail with Gandhi and fasted in Yerwada jail in Pune, he told them that you withdraw your fast. He even told Kelappan to withdraw his fast when he was fasting for the opening of Guruvayur temple. And many of Gandhiji's colleagues also were not in support of his fasting for several reasons. As some of them I've already said, you know, repeated fast, it doesn't have an impact. It is use of force. There's no logic to it. You know, it's an emotional blackmail. So Vallabhbhai Patel, Rajaji, one last I would like to read what Rajaji had to say, C. Rajagopalachari had to say to Gandhi when he wanted to fast. That people are in favor of opening up the temple is clear from the counting of votes. But we want to do all this legally and peacefully. There will be struggles all over the country. But since you continue to hang the threat of fast over our heads, how can we do all this work? You should give up the idea of fasting itself. All that needs to be done is being done. Once permission is received, law is passed, Guruvayur temple should be considered as open. I must say that with the talk of fast instead of goodwill, a lot of unpleasantness is being created. There is a limit to fast in order to awaken the conscience of the people. Hindu religion does not permit suicide. Buddha was also opposing violence to the self. You seem to believe that violence to self has strong bond with conviction, which is not true. You are experimenting with death. You have been misguided. So these kind of arguments are there from Gandhiji's colleagues, be it Vallabhbhai Patel, be it even Devdas, you know. So I think what I want to say is that there is a lot of strength in collective power, collective resistance. It's and it does achieve result. And I think we see the farmers movement, the movement against CAA, it's all decentralized.
Yeah.
You know, it's collective.
I'm glad you mentioned these contemporary movements, because that brings us to, in a sense, my wrapping up thought. A lot of young people today, these days, Nandini, are drawn to the concept of nonviolence. Okay, they feel attracted to it, but they feel very daunted. And some of them are unsure about how to proceed, both in terms of the inner strengths that are required for it, and also the external methodological questions. So in a broad sense, what advice would you give to such young people?
I think my screen must have frozen too. Sorry.
My last bit was, what advice would you give to young people who are drawn to nonviolence but unsure of it?
I think we have seen great results through collective and nonviolent struggles across the country. As I already named a few, you know, Koyal Karo, Subansri. The recent movements, the students' movements, the movement against CA, the movement by farmers, you know, it has put the government on the back foot. So recently, you know, a very massive movement by youth against the draft EIA, with 20 lakh emails, you know, actually crashed the Environment Ministry's server. So these are all collective resistance that are showing a lot of impact. And there's no need to feel discouraged. And that's the only way where you change the mind and hearts of the people that it's really going to achieve, is what I want to say. But at the same time, you know, there are two types of people fighting. There are Adivasis, Dalits, who are direct recipients of violence. You know, you have in Chhattisgarh, the army entering Adivasi villages. There, if people in self-defense, you know, I mean, it would be how to preach non-violence to somebody who's direct recipient, you know. So there, it's fine for us to talk while we have choices before us. There, I would say that the government should step back. No armed entry of police and forces on our own people. Dialogue should be the only way. And if there is a scuffle or if there is some sort of protest there, it should be seen in the law of the land. So, you know, sometimes just to save one's life, people may get involved in a scuffle or may protest in a different way. Then we must start thinking that, is this also not falling under the law of self-defense, private defense? The government gives us this right. The constitution gives us this right in self-defense. So we must think of these issues where people are directly recipients of unprecedented violence, you know. I mean, what will the people do there? But where we have a choice, we must. Non-violent, collective struggles have shown results, have shown results.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And all the best.
Thank you. Thanks to you.